So real quick question, who here has heard of Clojurescript? Who's used Clojurescript? Okay, Matthew,
you guys a little. You're the one guy.
Who's used Clojure?
A little.
Awesome. So I'm going to talk about Clojurescript. I actually got some goodies too. The weirdest thing happened today. I've been waiting over a month for Clojurescript swag from the guy that runs Clojurescript.info. So at the end of the talk, if you want buttons, I have a single button. So if someone really loves Clojurescript, after I talk about it. Otherwise, these awesome things you can put on your laptop, like me. You want to be like me? Or I have two buttons. So I'm trying to target this talk at JavaScript developers because I feel like Clojurescript, the entire ecosystem, could greatly benefit JavaScript developers, but none of the material is really targeting you guys. So here's my first cut. Here we go. So I always like to start presentations with quotes from Alan Kay because he's awesome. Simple things should be simple, complex things should be possible. And simple is a fundamental part of the Clojure language, and that extends to Clojurescript itself. And I'll actually define what simple means. One more quote from Rich Hickey. You want everything to be familiar, you'll never learn anything new. Be prepared to see things that are new. So, what is Clojurescript? Well, Clojurescript is Clojure. Clojure is a Lisp. It's a Lisp dialect, which is a family of languages that date back all the way to 1957. And it is also a functional programming language. And it is damn near a pure functional programming language, unlike Lisp itself. And we'll explain what that means here in a bit. It is hosted. Both Clojure and Clojurescript are hosted languages, which means they run on another language's virtual machine. In this case, Clojurescript targets the JavaScript virtual machines in everyone's web browsers. It is functional, like I said, it is a Lisp. It is strongly typed, unlike JavaScript, and it is dynamically typed like JavaScript. So, if people that think those are the same thing, let me tell you, you want strongly typed, pretty much always. And if you like JavaScript, you probably like dynamically typed languages. So, don't be scared. Those machines on the right, anyone know what those are? I know one person in this room knows what they are. Those are actual Lisp machines. They run Lisp at our hardware level, which is really profound if you know what Lisp is. But okay, enough of that. They're really cool looking machines. The lights on them are actual memory cells. And when they're lit up, that means there is data in that memory cell. Oh, wow. So you can actually look at the machine and see the data flowing through it. It's crazy. One more observation. Every time I talk about functional languages, I've been doing this for years, everyone nowadays looks at half my slides and says, oh, my language has that. Well, every imperative language like JavaScript, Java, C#, etc., they're adding more and more functional features every year. And we're just getting closer and closer to parity with real functional languages, which is a good thing. So I'm going to try to focus on the things that are different. A lot of this should be familiar to JavaScript developers. You already have some fundamental functional things like closures. The names I say here, but Clojurescript.
Can I ask a quick question about that picture?
Yeah.
What's the scale there?
Scale that?
If I stood next to it, how high are
the tiles? I don't know those tiles on the floor. I really don't know.
The ceiling's not too far.
These are some pretty fancy looking ones. The more modest symbolics machines were about 10 feet tall. So I think those are much more than 10 feet tall.
Tiles like that are typically 2 feet. So probably 7 or 8 foot tall.
Who's using this machine, Jim?
MIT. So Symbolics was a company that built the Lisp machines, and their big push was AI. And then the AI winter hit in the 1980s when someone wrote a paper about perceptrons. I won't get into it, but tanked the entire field for like a decade, and Symbolics died as part of it. But let's move on. I'm going to try really hard to not double Blaine's time, but hey, I have a timer up here, so I'll know I'm torturing you guys. So Clojurescript has the syntactic power of this, and what that means is it treats code as data. The code itself in the language is actually a data structure in the language. So the programs are actually expressed in the language's data structures, which means you can manipulate them. So you can write code that manipulates code. It has metaprogramming facilities in the form of list macros. It's composed of monotonic expressions, which means, again, that the code and the data are represented using the same syntax. And it has first-class functions and closures. So those are some of the core things that make a list a list. I won't go through the entire list because, frankly, JavaScript has most of them these days. So it's kind of a pointless exercise. And it has an emphasis on simplicity. It decomplexes state, identity, and value. Most languages conflate the concept of identity and value. In most languages, the identity of something, like my variable is called A, its value is actually a pointer to a memory location that contains its value. If you change the value at that memory location, you've now redefined A. You know, there is no separation of identity and state. Clojure addresses that with managed references, and it has immutable data, so your values cannot change, which makes that really easy to guarantee. It has a la carte polymorphism. I'm not going to touch on all the polymorphic aspects of it. I wanted to keep this as a kind of an intro to Clojure, but suffice it to say, it has a non-classical polymorphic system. So you can do things like adhere to interfaces, extend interfaces to other objects, etc. And the Clojure community prefers composing libraries over frameworks. And part of the reason for that is most Clojure programs and ClojureScript programs are expressed in just a few data structures, which makes it really easy to compose a solution out of disparate libraries. It is designed around immutability. This means all of your data is safe to share. In JavaScript, you guys don't worry about threads so much. You will. So this is good. They're also persistent. So these are immutable persistent data structures, which means under the hood, when you make a change to one of these immutable data structures, you're actually getting back a new data structure that shares structure with the old one. So you can think of it like Git. You know, you make a change to a file, Git's really only storing the diff. It's similar to that, it's a little more fancy than what Git does, but that's a good analogy. ClojureScript also has same value equality semantics. You can compare anything. You can compare anything in constant time. You can compare deeply nested data structures in constant time. And that's incredibly powerful, especially now that we have frameworks like React that depend on being able to diff complex data structures. And most functions in ClojureScript are pure functions, which means given the same input, they'll always give the exact same output, which makes it very easy to reason about your program. And again, back to composing large programs out of smaller libraries and components, being able to reason about how data flows through your system is very important. Like I mentioned earlier, it is a hosted language, so it compiles down to JavaScript. Believe it or not, it is compatible back to IE6. So every feature I talk about today, you can target IE6 with if you care to. So anywhere you can use JavaScript, you can use ClojureScript. So that means Node, that means web browsers, obviously. It has RapidList interop with JavaScript. So if you have a pure JavaScript library and you want to interact with it in ClojureScript, you can do that. You can also go the other direction. You can interact with ClojureScript code from JavaScript. It's not quite as pleasant going that direction, but it can. ClojureScript has advanced compilation as an option for when you're ready to ship your program. It uses the Google Clojure compiler, and what it does is it eliminates get code, so anything not reachable. So if you're using 20 libraries and you're using one function out of each of those 20 libraries, those libraries are megabytes apiece. It's okay. It'll only compile down to the code that was actually reachable in the program. It does minification after that, as you would expect. Ships a single file. So you don't have to worry about code size. You don't have to worry about breaking things into the smallest modules you can, so you can import just the functionality you want. Use libraries you'd like you use them in any other language. I have a note in my presenter notes that Google sucks at logos. That is Google's Clojure compatible logo.
Okay.
I actually had to make my own because they also didn't provide one bigger than 200 by 200 pixels. I don't think there's a single designer on that Google Clojure team. So, let's get to it. These are all of the atomic types in the Clojurescript language. So we have a simple type, and it is not going to mess up building on my slide. Anyway, we have a simple type, a keyword, which is a self-referential symbol. Like Blaine mentioned earlier, JavaScript has first-class symbols, while Clojurescript also has first-class symbols. Strings are what you would expect, integers, floats, exponent notation, just a little sugar on numbers. Regular expressions are a first-class thing, a literal, so you can pass regular expressions around as literals. Booleans are true and false, and undefined is nil. Everything in the Clojure language is truthy, except for false and nil. So there's no weirdness like, you know, zero being the same as false, or the string zero in certain situations being false. You can reason about truthiness fairly easily in this language. Here are the core data structures. We have a list data structure, vectors, maps, and sets. The first question people always ask me is, what the hell is the difference between a list and a vector? If you're a comp sci guy, you know. In this case, this is a singly linked list. So it's efficient to access it from the front sequentially. Vectors are random access with some time guarantees, like, you know, for how fast you can access anything in the vector. Maps are what you'd expect. Maps are an interface like everything in Clojure. The actual implementation could be an array map, hash map, depending on where you're using it, how you're using it. Clojurescript will pick the right implementation is. And sets are hash sets, always, and they're what you'd expect. All of these data structures are immutable and persistent. So if I were to make a change to that vector, I would get back an, in quotes, new vector that shares structure with the old one, and as I continue making changes, it'll create new vectors that all share underlying structure to be space and time efficient in lookups. They use what's called a hash tree. It's TRIE, as the underlying data structure. So yeah, if you're curious how these actually work. So yeah, those are the main data structures, and you get a lot of mileage out of these. These are all the special forms in the language. In most languages, you would call this the syntax. In a list, most of the syntax is defined using what are called macros. And macros, at the end of the day, eventually expand down to some combination of these things. And just a quick run through, def will let you define something in the language. So you can def a symbol to refer to something. That should be obvious. If is what you'd expect with a twist. Everything in Clojure is an expression. There are no statements. So if is actually an expression. So if test is true, you will get back as the return value the result of evaluating the then expression. Otherwise, it'll be the result of evaluating the else expression. Do will likewise return the last expression, the result of the last expression. We'll talk about lib bindings later. Don't worry about quote, unquote, var. Fn is how you create a function, in this case an anonymous function because it's not bound to a simple name. Loop, you'll pretty much never use loop directly, but that's the underlying iteration special form. It also gives you a recursion target, so you can do a tail call, optimized recursive calls. You have exceptions, a lot like what's already in JavaScript, try, catch, throw, finally. And there's JavaScript interop. So like I said, you can access anything in JavaScript from Clojurescript. At the end of the day, the dot, new, and set, and the AEN and a couple others I forgot to put on the slide, are all there are. So this is the bedrock in the language. You can construct the entire language out of this. And this, of course, is all implemented in JavaScript. So we can write Clojurescript on top of JavaScript. So, quick sidetrack here. C++, JavaScript, Java programmers all recognize this function call syntax. Clean, concise, couldn't imagine how this could be any simpler. This is a function call in Clojure. You would not believe how many people complaining about this. This is somehow confusing. The only conclusion I can come to is this. I don't know what else to say. You're going to see some parentheses. And if you notice, those parentheses are just moved a little bit. And in fact, you're not going to see a single more parenthesis than you would have seen in JavaScript. So stay calm. It's also worth pointing out. It's also worth pointing out that there are, you know, since there are no statements, there are no curly braces. There are no semicolons. Commas are white space, so they're optional. If you want them to make things more readable, use them. You don't have to. So very, very minimal syntax. So this is a function. This is an anonymous function. Takes x, returns x times its times two. Pretty straightforward. You'll notice that it is also a list. So it starts with an opening parenthesis, ends in a closing parenthesis, which was my list data structure, isn't it?
But Joe, your list data structure had a quote mark in front of it.
Yeah, well, so this... Shut up, Matt. I told myself I was going to get deep into macros and metaprogramming and all of that, and I doubt we'll have time or 15 minutes into this, and I will not tell you how many slides I have because I don't scare you. But so you'll notice this is a list. The first thing in the list is the fn form, that special form which defines a function. The second thing is a vector, which has a simple x in it. And the third thing is another list that starts with a function, the multiply function in this case. The simple x that we passed into the function and the number two. You can guess at what this does. And you also notice that it's prefix notation. Everything in ClojureScript is prefix notation. This is really just consistency. If you think about it in C, JavaScript, etc., you have like sine and cosine functions, those are prefix. Multiply and divide and add, those are infix. And like exponential notation in a lot of languages is postfix. And it becomes difficult to reason about a program that's also homotonic or expressing the code and the data structures if you have all these different ways to call things. So everything in ClojureScript is prefix notation, and that is actually leveraged to good effect. So anonymous function literals can be written like this. It's a hash open parenthesis and the function body. A percent sign will be the argument if you have two arguments. It'd be percent and percent two. If you have three, you can guess how this goes. Kind of like the shorthand syntax that Blaine showed in JavaScript ES6. You don't want to use this for multi-line functions. This is for a short function that you want to pass to, some operation, some higher order function. If you want to give your function a name, this is one way you can do it. So I have an anonymous function on the right, I have a symbol on the left, and I'm defining that symbol times two to be that function. Of course, it would be nice if we could combine the def and the fun into defin. So this defines a function with a name, much like function in JavaScript. Functions can also take doc strings. And the doc string will be added as metadata on the symbol, so it'll be available to anything that wants to read that metadata. So that's actually very useful. I encourage anyone that writes Clojure or ClojureScript, please write the doc string. If you can, it's easy. Helps people like me using your library. Functions, of course, like in JavaScript, can return functions themselves. So here is a function multiplier, which returns a function that multiplies its argument by the argument you get the multiplier. So you get back a function literal. You get back an anonymous function from this function. It is the inner function is a closure. All functions in ClojureScript are closures. So x is being closed over. Three variable x is being closed over.
Question. Do all functions always return things?
Yes. Always. Even if it's just null. Which probably means your function either does nothing, or it's performing some side effect, it's a bad function. But printing to the screen is a side effect, and sometimes won't print. So this is a joke that in a purely functional language, it's good for nothing and it's good for the room. The because if you can't perform any side effect at all on the external world, you're just heating up the room. All right. So here I'm calling multiplier for giving back times four function, calling it, works as you'd expect. Functions can also take variable numbers of arguments. Ampersand is the rest operator. So name and guests will take any number of arguments after name. So it takes at least one argument, as many as infinity arguments. So if I were to call this, notice that the body of this function returns a map. So that name, guest count, the count of the guests, and the guest list, which is the actual guest. So if I call this on those arguments, I'll get back that map. No surprises there. You'll notice, actually, we won't notice, I'm not going to talk about it. There is a let form, which is a special formula language which lets you create a lexical context. So here we have a let that is binding A to 5, M to 3, and B to the product of A and M, and passing those to the JavaScript map square root function. So here's a little bit of JavaScript interop. You'll notice you prefix it with JS slash, and square root is a function on the map object. So that's how you would call that. I got excited when Blaine talked about destructuring. Here's destructuring and closure. Destructuring is done inside of the let form. At the top, we're assigning A and B to 1 and 2 respectively. F and R will assign 9 to F, and all of the rest of that vector on the right, 8, 7, 6, 5, and 4, to R. The X underscore Y will break down 1, 5, 7, 2 into, you notice how it's a vector with a vector inside of it? That's actually destructuring the shape of the thing that it's destructuring. So it's going to take the 1, 5, 7, that's the first thing in the right-hand side vector, and assign the 1 to the X and the 7 to the Y, and ignore the 5 in between. And since I only have one thing inside of the outer vector on the left-hand side, it'll ignore the 2. So it's easy to reason about this after you use it a little bit. The shape of the thing on the left matches the shape of the thing on the right, and you pull out values at any arbitrary level of nesting. If you want to destructure a map, you can have a map as your left-hand side destructuring form, and a symbol and the key in the map that you want to grab the value from to assign to that symbol. So some val will be assigned to foo. And you can see how this would all print out if I were to print out those pairs of destructured arguments. This map destructuring is so common that there's also a shorthand form where you can pass a map with a keys key whose value is a vector of symbols that you want to destructure keywords out of the map with. So this will assign bar and bass to 23 and 12. Bar to 23, and notice how Baz isn't in, wish I could point at this, I feel your pain, but I'm gonna point this one. Notice how Baz is not in this map. You can also specify defaults if anything's missing, so Baz is being assigned to 4. So add bar and Baz to 27. This is also useful in the arglist to a function. Arglists to functions are let forms under the hood. So I can destructure the arguments to a function. So in this case, this will take any arbitrary length sequence of items and give me the third item. Here's a more real world use case of map destruction. Here I'm pulling out the first name and the last name in the map passed to this function, and using the goo.string format function to format it into a string. So I pass in that hash map, it could be a hash map, and it'll pull out first name, last name, and concatenate them. Any questions so far? you're either all completely understanding this or really convinced.
My coworker in my last job is that was saying, yeah, Clojurescript is a feature, it's gonna be amazing, you gotta try it. And I know. And this makes a lot more sense than anything he ever said to me.
But I'm also just trying to be that. So when you're teaching anyone a new language, you can either be an asshole and talk way over their head because you know the language and they don't. Or you can be nice and try to relate to things they do know, and I'm trying to do the latter, even though I'm really good at the former.
Great.
All right. So, collections. Everyone likes collections. So here's a vector called my vector at the top. There's a function called conj. It's a generic function which will conjugate onto any collection. So if you give it a vector as its argument, it's going to add the second argument onto the end of the vector. You'll also notice, sorry.
I was gonna say, if you have two vectors, is it gonna put a vector as like the fourth item on that?
Yes.
Okay.
It does what you would expect it to do. Notice how if I call my vector after conjing onto my vector, notice how my vector didn't change. So conj my vector 6 returns a new vector 1, 2, 3, 6. If I go and look at my vector again, it is still just 1, 2, 3. Again, immutable data structures. If I wanted to keep the result of that, I would assign it to something inside of a let binding, or I would def it to some symbol, or I would pass it to another function, most likely. Here is a math at the top person. So there's me, sort of. I can associate into person, that's associate. I can associate the employer key with the string cognate type to change my employer. And cognate type would be my employer starting in August, so this will, I'll execute this code then. I get back the new map. If I then want to change my age, so here I'm using the updateIn function, which takes a map, a sequence, in this case a vector, of a key path to the item I want to change, and a function to apply to the item that's already there. So here I'm passing it person. Bio age is the key path, which will dig down into that hash map inside of the hash map. And it will call inc, which is increment, on the number 30, return a new map where my age is now 31. But notice my employer is none because, you know, again, immutable data structures, I'm changing person again. I didn't say that change from the previous thing. Well, this is a pretty common pattern in Clojurescript. Sometimes you want to accumulate changes, and you don't want to have to def a bunch of things in the meantime or bind them to symbols in the let. This is the threading macro. It takes person and passes it in as the first argument to update in. It takes the result of calling update in and passes that entire result into, or as the first argument to assoc. So here I can apply both of those operations to person. The result of this threading macro form is going to be the hash map below where I've changed both of those things. Now, I kind of lied to you. I said that it passes the result of update in. What it is actually doing is it's what's called a macro, referred to as a threading macro. What it is actually doing under the hood, it will macro expand it, which is a way to tell this macro to expand into the code that it really is under the hood. That call actually expands to that list on the bottom. So you'll notice what it really did is it took person, put it in as the first argument to the update in form, and it took the entire update in form with person in it and put it in as the first argument to assoc. This is code writing code. And what's really cool about macros is you can write your own macros. So if there's some way that you want to transform code at compile time into some completely different code, macros are what you would use. I don't expect anyone to understand this unless you use Clojure. But this is all of the code for the threading macro. It takes any number of arguments. So that makes it really powerful. You can imagine constructing these workflows of 20 things, like take this and the result of and pass that in as the argument for that, and do 18 more things. Macros are an incredibly powerful tool. Fortunately, if you don't want to write your own macros, you don't have to. About 50% of the language itself is implemented in macros. But it's cool that you can actually introduce your own syntax into the language. And my next slide says everything I just said. So macros are functions that run at compile time. In Clojure, they can run at compile time, which might also be at runtime or read time, but we'll talk about that. The macros themselves are written in Clojure. Code is just data after all, so why can't we write functions that manipulate the data structure that is the code, return that new data structure, and have that be the code that you ultimately evaluate? This allows you to extend the language itself. It lets you do crazy things. Like the core async library is actually it's a library for ClojureScript that adds a whole new syntax to ClojureScript that will run inside the web browser that lets you perform asynchronous operations. And I'll talk a little bit about that later if I have time to show a demo. Real quick, this is the AND macro. So if I were to pass the AND macro three things and expand this thing, it actually expands into this. And it's what you'd expect. The crazy __ auto names, those are auto-generated symbols by the compiler, so it has a unique symbol to refer to the intermediate results. But what it's doing is it's really it's checking to see if expression one evaluates to something truthy. And if it does, check to see if expression two evaluates to something truthy. And if it does, check to see if expression three evaluates to truthy. If any of those things evaluates false, nil or false, it will return that. Otherwise, it will return the last truthy expression. Yes?
When you're debugging, do you debug at pre-macro level or macro level?
Hopefully pre-macro level. I mean, I always do. Yeah, macro expand all in this case is a debug tool, really, so you can see how things expand. But when you're stepping through code, you don't see the expanded macro. That would be horrible.
So what you're saying here, the top, the AND, is writing that bottom portion?
Yes.
Okay. So if I pass in 9 more arguments into that AND, it's going to write that 6 levels deeper.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. It expands the compile time. You never see it unless you care to see it. But heavy interpretation of AND, which is actually disturbingly simple. But I sort of didn't put it in this slide. Anyway, let's talk about state and identity. So values in ClojureScript never change. I think I beat that into the ground. Identity is important for modeling the world. Sometimes you want to give things names. Like my person symbol earlier, I changed what it meant to be that person. Sometimes you want to keep that name associated with the latest in a series of values that you want that name associated with. So, ClojureScript and Clojure define state as the values of an identity over time. So, I wrote this example about 15 minutes before I walked in the door, so hopefully this makes sense. So here I have an identity called all transactions. We're going to start with an atom, which is it's a mutable reference container. Now I said all the values in ClojureScript are immutable. I said nothing about references. References can be mutated in controlled ways inside of the atom reference container. I can swap the current value of all transactions with a function, so it's going to apply the function conj to the current value of the atom, which is just an empty vector. And I'm going to pass as its second argument this map. So at this point, all transactions contains that map. And the deref function, it's actually a special form, gets you the current value of that reference container. So we have an atom, which is an object. We have the value that the atom is pointing to. And only that pointer, that reference, is mutable. The values are not mutable. So if I were to take the current value of, ignore final price and social total, but the def t1, if I assign t1 to the current value of all transactions, t1 will forever be the current value of that. And so here I'm treating T1 is just a regular value. I'm calling this a social total function on it, and it's adding the total, taking into account the sum of all of the line items, the discounts, and the tax rate. I don't know why I did that. If I were to conj another item onto this, and if I were to look inside of this, you would see that now there are two transactions. If I def the now current value inside of that atom to T2, compare to T1, I'll see that they are not equal, and that that is not equal, not equal. Let's talk equality. So equality in Clojure is value-based. Constant time comparisons of atomic values for collections. This is easy because all of these immutable persistent data structures use a hash tree, which is a hashing structure, which means you have a hash of every value in the system. So an equality comparison is a hash comparison. It is literally comparing two numbers. Can't get faster than that. And there's no implicit conversion when you're comparing things. That wouldn't make sense since they're it's doing hash equality checking. So start simple. This is usually true. Joe is Joe. Two vectors, 123 and 123, those are equal. These are not equal, but I can compare them nonetheless. So here are two maps. They're not equal because a couple of the keys are not equal. It's the actual values in the collection that determine equality. So this vector on the left and this singly linked list on the right are equal. They contain the same values, and this is value of equality. The contains function uses equality to look up a value inside of a set to see if that set contains the value or see if that hash map contains a key of that value. So I can actually pass what is me just typing in this case, name Bob, occupation software engineer, employer LTCM, as an argument to contains. And even though that isn't the same object as the one that's in the set people at the top, it's a value comparison, so they are equal. And there's one person in this room that's going to get my lame joke with Goldman Sachs and Plumber. Really lame joke. All right, moving on. Sequences. All collections in Clojure implement a protocol called ISeq. I'm not going to talk about protocols or records or reifying or any of these abstract-oriented programming concepts. It's unfortunate I'm not talking about them because Blaine started touching on some of them in JavaScript, and they're really cool and really powerful to program against an abstraction rather than some concrete interface, or some concrete things interface. Anyway, all collections implement the ISeq protocol. Therefore, any collection can be consumed as a sequence, and that's really powerful. I can consume a list of items as a sequence of items. I can consume a map as a sequence of map entries. I can consume a set as a sequence of items in it. Anything that implements this interface, I can create my own data structures that implement this interface and consume them, iterate over them like I could any sequence. And what's really cool about these sequences is they can be realized lazily. There are only two functions you need to implement in your data structure, or have your data structure conform to implement the ISeq interface. And that is the function first and the function rest. The function first needs to return the first thing in your collection. And rest needs to return a function that when called returns a new sequence. And then on that new sequence, I can call first again and get the first thing. And I can call rest again and get a function that returns, again, the rest of the sequence. You can see how this would allow you to lazily value or lazily realize lists because rest might not actually just contain the rest of the items. It might contain a function that's generating the rest of the items. There is a very rich library built around the sequence protocol. I won't cover even a tenth of it, but I'll cover enough of it to give you an idea of how it works. So my vector is, it conforms to the sequence interface because it is a collection in Clojurescript. I can call first on my vector and get one. I can call rest and get 2, 3, 4, 5. The reason rest gave me everything is when it was printed out to the REPL, the live evaluation environment that Clojurescript and quite a few languages now have, it called first and got 2, and then it needed the next thing because it's trying to print out the entire data structure, so it called the function returned by rest, called first on it, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, until it realizes the entire list. Don't try to evaluate an infinite list inside of REPL. It won't stop. So here's a map. B4, A12, some key, another value. You'll notice that my keys in that map aren't all keywords. You can actually use anything as a key in a map. You can use any arbitrary data structure as a key in a map. So you can use maps as basically joiners between two lists of items to store relationships. my string, strings are sequences in Clojurescript. So I call first on my map and I get back this map entry. I get back the first key and the value in it. Now notice it's not the first as printed on the first line of this slide. When I create a map literal like that, it's going to default to a hash map implementation, which is unordered. It's hash order, actually. So that is the first thing, hash order, coming out of that map. If I call first on my string, I get back a single character string, JS, you would expect. Here's some really cool functions in this interface. I can say drop three of a sequence. It'll drop the first three items, return the rest of the sequence. Notice how it returns what looks like a list. That is actually the printed representation of the sequence. All of the sequence functions return a sequence. So you don't get back the original type of data structure, you get back the sequence, which is fine because you can always very freely convert it back to whatever data structure you want. So I can take five from a cycle of 3, 2, 1. Cycle returns an infinite sequence. That is the cycle of the items passed to it, or of the collection passed to it. So if you pass it 3, 2, 1, it's going to generate, in quotes, an infinite sequence of 3, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1 forever. I take the first five items of that and I get 3, 2, 1, 3, 2. I can drop the first, or take the second, or the first, or the rest of that list, five, or the list five. This is, would be a great place to use that threading operator that I showed you earlier. I can map functions across collections. So here I'm mapping the partial function times 2 across 1, 2, 3. Partial creates a function with less than the number of arguments that the function you pass to it takes. So multiply takes, in Clojurescript at least, 0 or more arguments. If you pass 0 arguments, you get back the number, what? This multiply. That would be bad. 1. The identity for multiplication is 1. So you pass it 1 argument, you get back that argument. It doesn't mean 1 times that argument. If you pass it any more, it will just multiply them all together. So partial times 2 is going to multiply each item in that sequence by 2, so I get back 2, 4, 6. Partial, of course, returns a function. So the first argument to map and filter functions. There's an odd function in Clojurescript, Clojurescript core. So I can filter a list by odd, get back just the odd items. There's also keep, remove, there's a whole bunch of higher order functions that take functions and apply them to lists in different ways. Here's a fun one. I'm going to define all numbers. This is all natural numbers. I'm iterating with the ink function on 1. So what this does is it takes ink, calls it on 1, takes the result of that, calls ink on it, takes the result of that, calls ink on it, keeps adding these to a collection forever. So, obviously this isn't being realized. I'm assigning the sequence, which can be lazily realized to the symbol all numbers, and now I can start taking from it. So, this is really fun. I'm partitioning into groups of 3 all numbers. Partition returns a lazy sequence, thank God. Otherwise, we'd be sitting here all day waiting for this, or I would have been. I can take the first 10 partitions of 3 out of all numbers, and that gets me that result there. Only a couple slides left. Hanging with me? Questions? That would be a great time for questions. Because my entire presentation just kind of goes off the rails after this. No? Comfortable? Good. Protocols. I said I wasn't going to talk about protocols. So these slides I actually copied and pasted out of my Clojure presentation I gave a couple years ago. So, real quick, they're interfaces. What's really cool about these is they can be extended to data types you don't know. In a lot of languages, you would accomplish something similar for monkey patching. And languages, anyone here an Objective-C developer, ever written Objective-C besides Matthew? Yeah, a little bit. You have categories. You can, basically, you can define an interface, you know, these 5 functions, and you can then implement those 5 functions on some type that you don't actually have the source code for, or access to the source code for. Which is really powerful. You know, I could add functions to the string type in JavaScript if I wanted to. Oh, there's even animations on these. Fancy. Here's an example. Here's a protocol called REST-NRD. And here's a record, which lets you create a type that adheres to the sequence interface, to a whole bunch of interfaces, actually. But here I'm extending the REST-NRD protocol to my person type, and gen REST-NRD and add links to the functions. that I'm adding to it. I don't actually need to own that thing to do this. Let's say I didn't own REST entity and I created a protocol called cat. I could extend that, I'm sorry. Let's say I don't own cat, which I don't, I'm allergic to them. And I created this REST entity protocol, and I want to extend it to cat. Well, I can do it like this. I can say, extend my protocol REST entity to cat, and here are the implementations of those two functions in the REST entity protocol on cat. Notice here I'm doing it to Java line string, and it's from my Clojure presentation. Same thing with JavaScript. I can extend functions to a JavaScript type. That's the basic syntax of it. I'm going to skip that. I'm going to talk real quick about namespaces, since Blaine talked about modules and, you know, this is competition. namespaces are modules in ClojureScript. Anyone that's ever written any Java code, they're kind of like packages. They actually look a lot like packages. So here is actually the namespace declaration at the top of my demo, which sort of kind of works, and you'll see here in a second. But the gist of it is, ignore the caret colon big will always. That's some metadata I'm putting on the CLJS for JS.core symbol. But that CLJS for JS.core is the namespace. So there are two components in this namespace. So you can imagine having, you know, my library dot utility functions as the namespace. Ignore require macros for now, but here's the require syntax. I'm requiring the library own.core, which is a React wrapper, as own. So I can now refer to it as own anywhere in my file. Same thing with this, you know, bootstrap. I'm including core async down there as async. Yeah, pretty straightforward. There are a lot of other things you can do inside the namespace macro, but this is how you include libraries inside of your other namespaces. Real quick, I want to touch on some of the core libraries that have been ported from Clojure to ClojureScript, which you will not find, frankly, anywhere unless someone's written them recently. That's a lie. There are some languages that have similar things. You won't find them in JavaScript. So core.match is a, how do I describe this? It's a structural matching library that lets you create really elaborate matching between data structures and this matching syntax that it has. It's really powerful for, think of it as a case statement on Crack. You can do some really fancy dispatch using core match. Core logic is a logic programming library. If anyone's ever heard of or used Prolog or Minikaren, this is that in Clojure. So instead of writing explicit code to get what you want, you can define a bunch of constraints and core.logic will find you the data that matches those constraints. So you can say things that sound a lot like database query, like give me all people whose first names contain the letter A who have worked at Nano Nation and like copy, and it will return that mechanism. Maybe some other people. Core.test.check is a generative testing library. If you haven't looked at generative testing, you've got to check out generative testing. If you hate unit tests, you've got to check out generative testing. The short of it is it lets you generate deterministic generated tests against your code. So it comes with a library of generators which take a seed, and given the same seed, it will return the same data. So you can generate 10,000 hash maps with various keys and values in it to pass to your function that takes hash maps. And it performs a step called minification, where it'll find a bunch of scenarios where your code blows up, and it will take all of those examples of data structures it's passed to it that caused it to blow up, and it will find the simplest case that causes the code to blow up. This is insanely powerful. And if you want an amazing video to watch, John Hughes, one of the authors of Pascal, the programming language, wrote a quick check for Erlang and Pascal. And he has an amazing presentation from Clojure West 2014, if you feel so inclined to look it up, where he shows using quick check against Volvo's in-car software that manages all of the systems in the cars. And he ran it also against the specification for the software. And he found tons of bugs in the software itself and in the specification, but the specification was internally inconsistent. you know, things that no human being can sit down and actually find. I mean, these are difficult bugs that all the have been trying to figure out for years, but you know, we spent a few days running this off and on and found. And this last library is Corey. Has anyone here used Go yet? Go's hot. People like Go, right? Go?
Yeah.
Go? Don't. I like saying provocative things in the Midwest dev chat. Like Go is one step forward and two steps backwards. I chose
you.
That was me. Great. Carl.
Existential.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I also say mean things about PHP. Shit.
I don't
know.
Most people say
me. I know, I'm so bad, right? I don't actually know what I'm... I've used PHP. I don't know what modern PHP is because I haven't used it. I haven't used it for years. Anyway. Core async is communicating... Yeah, that's my core. Core async is communicating sequential processes, which a guy named Tony Gore talked about back in the 80s. The short of it is, you have a bunch of asynchronous blocks of code that are executing asynchronously, and they communicate with each other over an abstraction called channels. And what's cool about channels, well, there's a lot of things that are cool about channels, but one, this allows you to decomplex your system, pull apart, you know, it allows for real separation of concerns in your systems. It also allows for concurrency, and it also allows for metering of data flow through your system. These channels exert back pressure. So they work a lot like pipes, like real pipes with water in them. If you have a producer and a consumer, and that producer is producing things faster than the consumer can consume them, the producer will be blocked. He will not be able to put anything on that channel, so he'll block there. Now he's inside of his own async block of execution, so he's not blocking the rest of the program, but he'll stop until the consumer can start pulling stuff off again. Likewise, if the consumer is pulling too fast and the producer's not producing fast enough, the consumer will block. Sometimes you want there to be some leeway in there. You want there to be a buffer, so you can have, you know, a buffer of say 20. So the producer can be 20 ahead of the consumer, and it won't block until it, you know, fills up the buffer. And there's all kinds of core async. What makes it, in my opinion, a superior CSP implementation to Go in the programming language is, how much time do I have? I got like 15 more minutes.
With everyone?
Better. Okay. I told him to lock the door, so I don't think he actually did it. What I like about Core Async in ClojureScript, and oh, by the way, this is in ClojureScript, so you can use this in the web browser for real concurrency. Not you know, promises are cool. They have a place. But they exhibit something kind of like callback hub, where you can chain all these promises together. They're really ad hoc or one off. You know, you ask for some computation before you deliver that promise is now dead, right? These core async blocks of code can execute indefinitely, keep feeding a channel throughout the life of your program. They can terminate at some arbitrary point in time, whatever. They're a great abstraction, but back to what I really like about core async versus Go is this has a really, really rich library of different channel types, different concurrency semantics. Some of you are probably here for the transducers talk and were probably really confused. I promise transducers in ClojureScript. If you remember the map and filter I showed you earlier, that's how complex they are. They're part of the language. But you can filter a channel with a transducer. If you didn't get the gist of the transducer talk, a transducer allows you to compose together a bunch of computations that operate on sequences into a single computation that performs all of those steps on each item as they're pulled through your transducer, rather than generating all of these intermediate results. You can imagine a MapReduce operation. You're mapping a function across a bunch of data, and then you're reducing with some other function. Well, you've in the meantime created this intermediate map, which is taking up space and, you know, takes time to generate. And, you know, it'd be nice if you could do that map and reduce at the same time. That's what transducers are doing. And you can use transducers with channels. Channels can also be tapped into. They can be multiplexed. They can be mixed, joined together. You can have sliding buffers where only the newest two things are on the channel. You can have dropping buffers where once they're full, they just drop new things. You can imagine all kinds of scenarios where this would be useful. Check out Core Async if you actually, you know, take me up on trying it out. That's it for my slides. There's only 68 of them. Since we have a couple of minutes, since no one said they're running out, I do have a quick demo here. People lately have been telling me my Emacs looks really weird. Well, it's not up there. It's not up there.
For what it's worth, some guy on Quora agreed that that core.async makes everything else worthwhile. There's so many problems that become callback hell on JavaScript, where you really have problems trying to adjust to add more machines to improve performance or add more cores, or how do I handle all these callbacks that are happening? And you plug it into something like Go or core.async, and it just is so easy. So
I'd argue it's easy to reason about. When I said Go was one step forward and two steps backwards, I also broke that down into it was one good step backwards and one bad step backwards. And the good step forward is CSV, you know, it has these Go blocks, as if you're just communicating blocks of code. The good step backwards was it gives object-oriented programming the middle finger, which, you know, someone with the interest in functional languages and, you know, traditional classical object-oriented languages do conflate state and identity and make it really hard to reason about programs in a multi-threaded environment, damn near impossible, and they have mutable data. The bad thing about Go, in my opinion, and, you know, I haven't built anything real in Go, so I'm going to preface it, what I'm about to say with that, but I think it was a really bad design decision to give us concurrent sequential, or communicating sequential processes with mutable primitive data types. I mean, you have a concurrency semantic built into the core of the language, but you're going to be passing around mutable data. I mean, this is just asking for trouble. It's asking for locking and all of the things that CSV was supposed to help us avoid. So that's my two cents. I asked this earlier, if anyone wrote closure code, and one person, two people, raised their hand. Do you think
I'm bigger?
Zoomed in. So this is a REPL. And it stands for read eval print loop, and all it means is exactly what I just said. It reads reads something off the line, it evaluates it, it prints the results, and it loops back around. So if I were to say, you know, map a comprise 1, 2, 3, a real simple example inside of this REPL, now you see the result. Can anyone see that? So this is a REPL. This REPL is a special REPL. It's plugged in. It's actually evaluated inside that web browser on the left. So you know, I can do a.
Because you're processing baselines and all
that. Something that designers should fix. Hey. So this REPL is actually running inside of this web browser. You can imagine the implications of this. This REPL is running inside this web browser, and any code I change gets immediately evaluated in the REPL. So this code over here is rendering that on the left. This list of Clojure and Clojurescript books. I can, for example, say add a paragraph. So this is Ohm, which is a React wrapper. Add a paragraph up here, and you know, save this file. And you'll notice it immediately appears over there on the left. There's some state in here. If I filter this list, it's currently filtering by title or to filter Clojurescript. You know, it has that book. If I make another change over here, like change this string up here in that paragraph, and say. You notice it changed, but the state of my application did not get wiped out. This is a really powerful way to program because you can imagine being 12 menus deep in your application and you're, you know, finding some bug. It really sucks. I've experienced this most of the days of my programming life, where I'm troubleshooting something where it takes a while to get back into the state I need to be in to reproduce it, and then I make some code change, and then I have to go. You know, reload everything and get back into that state. It doesn't matter if you have a live coding environment if it blows away your current state of your application every time. Clojurescript, this Clojurescript REPL does not blow away the state of your application every time, which is really cool.
Does that REPL require you to be intelligent?
Oh, no. Okay. No, in fact, so the REPL is implemented as a service just run on a system that anyone can write an ID plugin. When I said earlier that this, people have been saying my Emacs looks funny lately. I'm an Emacs guy. If anyone knows what that is, you know, it's not Vim, so it's better. Emacs is written in Lisp.
There you go.
I used to be a Vim guy, and I used to make fun of all the Emacs guys because you need like six arms to really use Emacs properly. But I've gotten pretty good at it with my two arms. But at the end of the day, I'm not going to exploit the virtues of Emacs. That'd be a waste of everyone's time now. Real quick here, I wanted to show off some core async. And to do that, it's some bigger code. Let's shrink this rubble down, we don't need it. So, what I haven't shown you about this book list is it's consuming a server sent event stream from a server that I stood up. And if I change that list of books out on the server, it will be immediately reflected in all connected clients. And how that's happening on the client side is I have this Go loop right here. And this is pretty easy to understand. I have an SSE channel, which is a Go channel, that is having the results from the server placed on it. And I'm pulling stuff, this less than exclamation point means pull something off the channel. It's going to block until there's something to pull off, because I'm a consumer, right? It's going to block until there's something there. And when there is something there, it's going to pull it off, and it's going to assign it to event. When event, when it's not false or nil, I'm going to read that string that was sent to me. It's coming in a DAT format called event. In this case, it's basically serialized Clojurescript, which looks exactly like Clojurescript. It's going to assign it to books, and then it's going to transact that into my React app. And if you know how React works, that's going to. It's going to change the state, it's going to do all the fancy, fun thing that React does. If you want to know more about React, we won't talk about it up here, but come talk to me about React. I'm really excited about React. And then it's going to recur. It's going to try to pull something off again, and it's just going to loop forever. So as long as there are changes to pull from the server, it will keep running this. If the server sends nil or false down, it will close the SSE connection. So this is really cool because I could do this with promises and some set timeout stuff, or I could use the event source library to do some stuff. What's neat about this is it's asynchronous, and I could queue up like 12 changes from the server and apply them at my leisure. I don't need to immediately execute that code. I can lock it here too. I could sleep for 10 seconds if I wanted to. You can't do that in a JavaScript application. I can inside this code block. And you'll notice that it's only like 6 lines of code. So I mean, it's very expressive. On the server side of this, magic. On the server side of this. Don't worry too much about this. This is a web server called Pedestal, which has some really cool features, including it can indefinitely pause and then later resume a thread context on a different thread, so you can handle, your server will never go down because you have too many connections, with long polling or SSE connections that can be developed. Same kind of thing's happening on this side. When a change happens in this database up here, which contains all of my books that are read in from this even file over here, this is called books. Whenever that changes, it will notify over this event channel each connected client. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail here because that could get pretty verbose, but let me show you it working. I have a function that lets me add and remove books. So here we'll open up a rebel over here. We'll open up the closure rebel on the server side. And I'm going to remove the first book. Let me switch to the right name space. Switch to the same space. And I'm going to call this remove book function. It takes a book as its argument. So I'm going to say, give me my dereference database at, well, it's the same as deref. So give me my dereference database and give me the book's key value out of it and give me the first book. And we're going to pass the result of that to the remove book function. And hopefully one of these books over here disappears when I hit enter. I need to do load this file. No, that's right. And let's refresh over here. Because when things don't work, just refresh, right? And eventually I'm going to remove all the books. I wonder if it's because I'm filtering. Okay. Okay, I'm getting async errors, and you know what, let's just call this a dead example. I'm getting cores, header, errors. This might have something to do with the environment I'm connected in right now, actually. Anyway, I'm going to call it. Thanks.